Sorry. So my topic of the day is the effectiveness of homeopathy in mental disorders, glorious journey into past, present, and future Hahnemannian perspective. I'm Dr. Mukhtinder Singh. So Hahnemann was less keen to explore the psychological or psychic causes of sickness in starting, and he seemed to play down the significance of such factors. So even a homeopath has a lot to do with the mental symptom. So in homeopathy, that still remains a more or less blank sheet even to this day. So the possibility of homeopathy exploring this is still unexplored. So what Dr. Hahnemann said about treatment of maniacs, he said that I never allow any insane person to be punished by blows or other painful corporeal inflictions, since there can be no punishment where there is no sense of responsibility, and since such patients only deserve our pity and cannot be improved, but must be rendered worse by such rough treatment. We all know till date, the treatment for maniacs is chaining, giving strong medicine, the sedation. So just a brief introduction about mania, what mania is, then I'll be going again retrospective to the back. So there are many symptoms of mania: sudden change in energy and activity, mood variability, speech disruptions, changes in thought patterns, impaired judgment, development of psychosis, and there's a long, long list. So mania is also known as maniac syndrome. It is a state of abnormally elevated arousal, effect, and energy level, or state of heightened overall activation with enhanced affective expressions together with lability of affect. So this is something, when we called a person a maniac or a mad or a fool, not fool actually, mad or maniacs are the terms used in when one loses its reasoning. So when total loss of reasoning is there, and mania is sometimes not a stable state, it comes and goes. Although mania is often conceived as mirror image to depression, because these days there are lot many cases of depression, and if you go to the psychological evaluation, as I earlier told, I'll be going a bit fast because this is a huge, huge topic. So it is a kind of a mirror image to depression, the heightened mood. In depression, we see patient goes down in his energies, in his senses, in everything. But when it goes reverse, means heightened mood, either euphoric or irritable, indeed, as the mania intensifies, irritability can be more pronounced and result in violence or in extreme anxiety. So the symptoms of mania are heightened mood, either euphoric or irritable. The person can be too much happy or too much irritable or angry, like we have belladonna, stramonium, camphor, corium. So flight of ideas and pressure of speech. So his speech is not a normal speech. There is an increased energy. There is decreased need for sleep. Patient won't sleep at all, and hyperactivity. So in medical terminology, so it is plainly evident in fully developed hypomanic state. It is called hypomanic state. In full-blown mania, however, they undergo progressively severe exacerbations and become more and more obscured by other signs and symptoms, such as delusions and fragmentation of behavior. We know there are lot many delusions, and we'll be talking that in cases. So mania has many causes, but it mostly a symptom of bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder means two opposite states, not just like anhedonia. Sometimes we just relate opposite state or double wheel to only to anhedonia, but this is a huge, huge spectrum of disorders and can be more intense for the people diagnosed the type called schizoaffective disorder. So it's called as schizoaffective disorder. So schizophrenia comes under this. Mania can be symptom of other conditions, such as it is not that mania is an independent condition. It can come with multiple sclerosis because patient is on prolonged disability. Certain medications may perpetuate a maniac state. For example, prednisolone, too much use of steroids, or substances of abuse such as caffeine, cocaine, anabolic steroids, we know drug addiction might lead to the hypomanic state. So many in current manual of disease, hypomanic episodes are separated from more severe full manic episodes, which in turn are characterized as either mild, moderate, or severe. So now the terminology has been changed. So I'll tell you the homeopathic terminology, because if we have to explore it through homeopathy, we should know the homeopathic terminology. But if you talk to the modern science, you need to know the modern terminology also. So catatonia, psychosis, and they relate it with the mild, severe, moderate, and profound. So this diagnosed DSM-5 says manic episode criteria. So there are distinct period of abnormally and persistently elevated irritable mood lasting more than 1 week, and 3 or 4 of these symptoms, which are those inflated self-esteem, decreased need for sleep, pressured speech, or more talkative than usual, flight of ideas or racing thoughts, distractibility, means like in ADHD, patient is not able to concentrate on a topic, psychomotor agitation or increase in goal-directed activity, excessive involvement in activities with potential for painful consequences. So any of 4 of these symptoms and above 2 conditions, if they persist more than a week and the mood is abnormally elevated, then you can call a patient a maniac. So mania in bipolar can look similar to ADHD in children. We know that ADHD child, autistic child, so you need a lot of expertise to properly diagnose a case. So someone experiencing either or both should go through assessment in order to find treatment, as mania can get out of control. Now, ADHD is a clinical condition, but if it goes to the mania state, it can be out of control and lead to dangerous situations. So when it is, in other words, in our language, if we say, if the things go syphilitic, totally out of control, then they become the mania. So mania is another mania and bipolar, which can suddenly change to a low mood or depression, which is why diagnosis help, because treatment is going to be different for each individual. So this is where homeopathy comes in. So there is no common treatment, as manic episodes can look different and feelings are described differently by other state. So say sometime patient come, they are in one state, they are too low, in other state they are too high. And there is a category of patient who are sent into the asylum, because they are always into the above states. So about medication, medication isn't always the answer, because even in allopathy, whatever medicine is given, for schizophrenia, for mania, they are never sufficient, because they benumb the patient, they sedate the patient, but they have no definite treatment. And it is for sure, there is no treatment for mania in allopathy or other sciences. So always, but if they, what they do is, they do with the medications, they pacify the patient, they manage the patient, but there is no treatment. And homeopathy, I will tell you, has a great edge, and this is an unexplored field. We have left it unexplored. So before that, I said little introduction, there are 3 stages of mania. Hypomania, as we called, stage 1, acute mania, stage 2, and 3rd is delirious mania. Hypomania, acute mania, acute stage, and delirious mania, where the things are totally out of control. So mania is not a simple or a simple diagnosis as we made. It is a diabetes, it is a hypertension, it is depression, it is anxiety disorder. No. Mania has lots and lots of vectors, lots and lot of spectrum. So it varies in intensity from mild mania, delirious mania, marked by such symptoms, disorientation, florid psychosis, incoherence, and catatonia. So mania rating tools are there. So there are standardized tool, Atman self-rating mania scale, Young mania rating scale, but there is no particular investigation as such. It is only the rating scales. So, and people have related mania with creativity, because mania and hypomania also long been associated with creativity and artistic talent. So we see that people in higher achievements, they are not like normal people. They are to some extent mania. It has been the people in extreme research, people, they are not like everyone. So there are many things that पागल होना जरूरी है किसी चीज में अचीवमेंट करने के लिए. सो देर इज अ क्रिएटिविटी, देर इज अ सेंस. एंड ऑल मैनियक्स आर नॉट ऑलवेज सरफेस्ड बिकॉज पीपल विद मैनिया समटाइम दे हाइड देयर. सो इट इज नॉट ऑलवेज द केस दैट द क्लियरली मैनिक बाइपोलर पर्सन नीड्स और वांट मेडिकल हेल्प. एंड दीज आर द पेशेंट विच कम टू अस. दीज आर द पेशेंट हु आर नॉट डिक्लेयर्ड मैनियक बट दे आर सफरिंग अलॉट विद इट. सच पर्सन कैन either retain sufficient self-control to function normally or are unaware that they have gone maniac severely enough to be committed or commit themselves. So people, they have a lacuna of being labeled as maniac. So manic person can also be mistaken for being under the influence of drug. So people will ask, "Pee rakhi hai kya? Are you a mad? Are you a drunk?" But basically the people with mania, they are not like that. Now coming on to step two, because I have formed at least six steps, so see how much I can justify today. So a mental illness in early homeopathy was inspired from the Freud mental disease, and they were categorized in nine type of disorders. So these classification includes number one, that congenital disorder like infantile mental deficiency. So autism and all these patients will come under this. Idiocy, mental retardation patients will come under this. Imbecility and cretinism with or without epilepsy. So these are the same patients which are called maniac, come under the category of manic, first category of manic, where they are born like that. Second and third are epilepsy with mental disorder. So epilepsy and mental retardation, we get many cases out of this. So general paralysis or paralysis of insane. So those are kind of dependent kind of insane people. Fourth category is acute mania, including mania with acute condition, chronic condition, recurrent mania, puerperal mania, senile forms, alcohol and drug induced mania. So there are different type of manias under this. Fifth category comes under hysteria. We get many hysteric patients, but hysteria, if it goes like Moschus, like many other remedies. So it is totally fully blown case are definitely difficult to handle. So acute and chronic hysteria also comes under mania when it is out of control. Then sixth is melancholia, including acute, chronic, recurrent and puerperal and senile form. So even melancholy as in acute, there is puerperal form. In melancholia, there is a all these needs a lot of explanation. Then comes dementia of primary and secondary, senile and organic form. So dementia is of many cases. I have many cases of dementia, which in homeopathy helps a lot. So dementia with mania are the most difficult cases to handle. People go, so they can be caused by some pathologies in brain, tumors, hemorrhage. We all know cerebral atrophy, brain damage. So that can lead to dementia. Then mental illness in early homeopathy. So I recently had a case of, I just will show you, tell you a little of it. So this was a person who got herpes, and after herpes, in herpes he said that I have lots and lot of cases pending, the cases, I don't want to leave it to my son. And he was in a staring and total out of control state. And suddenly he was sent to the neurologist and then to the psychiatrist. And how homeopathy helped, I'm just telling you a verbal case. I'll show few videos also. So the person was having this hurriedness that I should settle everything. And another symptom matches, petroleum helped that patient in this senile dementia. There was a lesion in the brain because it was after suppression of herpes, skin disease. So petroleum helped that person. So I'm not coming to the cases right now because it is a long topic. So I'm hurrying, rushing through. Then is delusional insanity. We are talking about nine type of mania mentioned into our homeopathic literature. Then is delusional insanity, monomania and paranoid disorders, all schizophrenias, all delusion patient, all they come under this. And then mental illness in early homeopathy, the ninth category was moral insanity associated with delusional religious and ethical issues. So there are many patients which come under this kind of mania. Now, what is source of this? I have taken all that information from old books. Nothing is mine in this. So in the Organon, the old homeopathic literature and in Repertory and Materia Medica. Before I go to step two, I'll mention few of the aphorisms where it is written. Aphorism 210 says, in Hahnemann speaks of diseases of gist, that is rational, spirit, intellect, and sensorium, which we all are dealing. And other are diseases of gamut, where emotional disorder, heart and the body, and notes that all disorder, mind, body are altered to some degree. So gist and gamut, this has been, I'm not going to, Dr. Mahajan is there, he's better person to explain that. I'll rush through my presentation. So then into 1-3 aphorism, Dr. Hahnemann say there is lot of importance of totality, means symptom of disease and symptom of patient, both in acute and chronic are to be considered. Then aphorism 215, so many so-called mental and emotional diseases are somatic complaints that one-sidedly transfer to the mental and emotional organs. We know, as I told you, this was a case of herpes and going to the mind. Causes of mania in organ and of medicine. So aphorism 221 and 22 and 216, this Hahnemann spoke of acute insanity and mania caused by fright, vexation, abuse of spiritual liquor, and as well as kind of melancholy or mania. The nine types I just told. Aphorism 210, Hahnemann suggests, 223, sorry. Hahnemann suggests that all organic mental disorder have their origin in the chronic miasm and need treatment with anti-miasmatic remedies. Then aphorism 224, there are mental disorder caused by faults of education, bad practices, corrupt morals, neglect of mind, superstitious or ignorance, and organic cases called by miasms. Then again, aphorism 225, 226, by comparison, there are fewer mental illnesses that develop in an inverse manner and are disorder that are first spun and maintained by soul. This line is very important. Spun and maintained by the soul. If time permitted, if I reach that part of presentation, I'll explain that. Then the founder noted that the treatment of violent, insane, maniac, and melancholic patient should take place in a homeopathic asylum. Now, this was in aphorism 229. And I'm very surprised to know that very few of us are aware about a mental asylum. Because Hahnemann and mental health in 1792 to 93, this is a period of Dr. Hahnemann's life when he moved to Gotha, where the Duke offered him his hunting lodge in Jorchethal, a center for the treatment of mental in late 1792 to 1793. Hahnemann was 38 years old at that time. What happened was this, at that time, a brief history, how maniacs were handled. So the treatment of mentally ill was deplorable in Hahnemann's time. It was common for the patient to be chained, abused, whipped, beaten, and given strong narcotics and toxic medicine, even today. So these perceived to be lunatics, those who were perceived to be lunatics, were strapped down on a horizontal board that could be quickly turned on an axis to a vertical position or put in a so-called rotating chair. So these and other violent methods were considered shock therapy. And we all are aware. So this is one of the older chairs used in Europe for this kind of shock therapies. We all know, even today. I'm not audible. For whom? Someone type. Dr. Harsha, I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that may be a particular issue for the. So those perceived to be lunatics were strapped down. We know the shock treatment. And so how maniacs were handled? We all know what happens in the asylum. The homes for insane were little more than dirty prison and dungeons. Although the physical condition have improved over time, now they are neat and clean. But the allopathic treatment for insane mostly consists of drug, suppression amounting to chemical lobotomy and electroshock therapy. You know, there they remove the part of brain. Lobotomy is done. Lobe is removed. A brain is removed to make the patient a vegetable. Treatment of insane by mildness rather than coercion. So these are the photos which speak of themselves, that how insane were treated in the past. I'm not going into the detail. So how such treatment can be called humane? From the earliest years of Hahnemann's career, he was interested in humane treatment of mentally. Now, Hahnemann was in the further slides, I'll tell that he was a pioneer of modern psychology also, psychiatry also. From 1792 to 1802, please mute yourself. Who is there? Dr. Harsha, please mute all. From 1792 to 1802, Hahnemann dedicated some of his time to care of patients who were suffering from psychological disorder. So you see, some lunatics has written, it was more fun in hell. So the asylums were worse than hell. But what were the problems faced by Dr. Hahnemann? So as managing these kind of cases is very time consuming. He would only undertake the treatment of few person at a time, so has to be able to give each patient a special attention. Throughout Hahnemann's career, he continued to battle for more enlightened treatment of mentally disturbed using psychology and homeopathy. So we all know Hahnemann was a very, very proactive and very voracious worker. So life is short and he has lived many life in his lifetime. So in his letters to the different patient, psychiatric patient, he has told that he took care in matter related to given importance to the rest, to the diet, to the hygiene, to lifestyle and psychological reading. So Dr. Hahnemann in his lesser right, Dungeon edition, he writes that I never allow any insane person to be punished by blows or other painful corporeal inflictions, since there can be no punishment where there is no sense of responsibility, and since such patients only deserve our pity and cannot be improved. So the patients who are handled in this way, they can be pitied, but they cannot be treated, but must be rendered worse by such rough treatment. This was Dr. Hahnemann. So when I was saying that he moved to in 1792, this Duke of Gotha, this was one of the relatives. This Glockenbrink was one of the insane person who was a relative of that Duke. Duke is like king of the area. So he handed over this case to Dr. Hahnemann and gave him his estable and gave acres of land for him to live. And Dr. Hahnemann lived for 1.5 year with this patient, single patient. He took 1.5 year of his life for his first insane patient to be treated. So he observed for the first 2 weeks, because before the first 2 weeks, he just observed him and then he started his treatment. So judging by the symptom, Hahnemann used white hellebore and veratrum album. So this is Rosa, his insanity, footnote page 248, this is written. There was another authority in psychiatry, Wachhaus. He wrote that a cure of mentally disordered, Hahnemann believed, was to be accomplished partly by the physiological means, partly by dealing with the physical basis of life through medicine. Now he says that physiology means the circadian rhythm of the patient, the normal physiology, because we all know that in severe corporeal, in severe mental cases, there is no ailment on the body. Body is normal. But he still says that physiological means the correct sleep, correct diet, correct living style, all these. And then through physical basis, symptoms are to be handled through medicines. Physicians have about veratrum album. Dr. Hahnemann in Materia Medica Pura says in about veratrum album, physician has no notion of power possessed by this drug to promote a cure of almost one third of insane in lunatic asylum. This is what he said, that only if you master this drug in maniacs, You can treat one third of insane in lunatic asylum, whole world, one third of maniacs can be helped partially or fully by veratrum album only. This is not me, I'm saying. This is what Dr. Hahnemann has written. At all events, as homeopathic intermediate remedy, means veratrum album is a, for him at that time when he wrote this, was a must remedy for treatment for veratrum, the maniacs. Because they know not the peculiar kind of insanity in which to employ it, nor the dose in which it should be administered in order to be efficacious and yet not injurious. So he said veratrum album can be blindly given to all. I'm not advocating this kind of practice, but see in literature what Dr. Hahnemann has read about, wrote about veratrum album, that if you know the correct usage of this drug, this will come in play once or any time as intermittent, as supporting remedy, as main remedy, and you can help one third of insane in this world with this single remedy. I'm audible. Someone has again typed that I'm not audible.
Sir, the voice is clear, sir.
Okay. So Hahnemann, now there was another Frenchman, Pinel, who is considered to be a reformer of treatment of mentally ill, but doesn't records the facts in his biography of Hahnemann that this was the person who is credited to be the reformer of treatment of mentally ill. And he said that when Hahnemann was applying his principle of moral treatment to the practice, moral means not punishing, not chaining, not harming their body, Pinel made his first experiment of unchaining the maniacs of Basset. So modern science says Pinel is the pioneer, but he said Hahnemann was already doing this. Lecture on Theory and Practice of Homeopathy, R.E. Duggan, in an introductory lecture. So Hahnemann refuted to the commonly held view that the insane were incurable. Now, this is line to be born in heart of all us. Dr. Hahnemann himself has dealt, and he has declared it that insane are not incurable. Mind it, revise it to your mind that insane are not incurable. So, in addition of homeopathic remedies, Hahnemann and those around him also applied psychology, mesmerism, and homeopathic mind cure. Now, in treatment, these three, psychology, applied psychology, mesmerism, and homeopathic mind cure are also necessary things. Like the early homeopaths, today's practitioners study contemporary psychology, especially Jung's work, to assist in their understanding of human psyche. So we should also read the modern psychology, psychiatry. Hahnemann's homeopathic asylum was later. So I told you that Hahnemann told what he has written in Organon, that for that we need a homeopathic asylum. So there was a homeopathic asylum in history, foundation of large facilities that treated thousands of patients in the golden year of homeopathy in USA. You know, homeopathy is now banned in USA, but there was a golden day. How much golden? I'll show you. So one such institution was Middletown State Homeopathic Hospital in Middletown in New York. And see the grandeur of this institute. Middletown State Hospital in Middletown opened in 1874. This institution has a large complex of 47 buildings. See, 47 buildings only in one hospital, and that a specialty hospital. 3,092 beds. Mind it, 3,092 beds, 17 staff homeopaths, large number of nurses, and large pharmacy which carried no allopathic medicine whatsoever. 3,000 beds and no allopathic medicine in the hospital. See the legacy we have, but we are unaware of it. We don't know, and we have forgotten that legacy, and we are not following the legacy, and we are not carrying that forward. Treatment were carried out strictly along with lines introduced by Samuel Hahnemann in Organon of Healing Act. Middletown Institute treated 11,000 patients. See the data, 11,000 patients between its inauguration in 1874 to 1916. So see, around 26 plus 16, 42 years of working of this, it has treated 11,000 patients. And it was described as the finest homeopathic insane institution in the world, of which the school may be justly proud. Because since its establishment, the treatment employed has ever been of the strictest homeopathicity, and results have been little short of marvelous. This is what Cases of Homeopathy Julian Winston has written. So it was total homeopathy, no allopathy, and 11,000 patient cured, and one of the finest institute in the world. See the grandeur, see the homeopathy. These days our youngsters say that we need to change our way of practice. No, we need. So I usually say, if someone makes a plane and plane fails to fly, no one blames law of aviation. Everyone will say that one who has made that plane has failed to apply the law. Same way, if we are not getting that marvelous edge to homeopathy, we are failures. It's not homeopathy. Now, this Selden Haynes Talcott, this was the superintendent of institute, and he worked there 1842 to 1902. He was also professor of mental disease at New York Homeopathic Medical College and Hospital. He graduated from Hamilton College in 1869 and New York Homeopathy College in 1872. Dr. Talcott was chief of staff at Ward's Island Homeopathic Hospital in New York City from 1875 to 1877. And in April 1877, he took over the administration of Middletown Hospital, which he headed until his death in 1902. All that is history. That is not my creation. His lectures at medical college were recorded and presented in textbook called Mental Diseases and Their Modern Treatment, published in 1901. And I'll show you some of the glimpse of that book. At the Middletown State Homeopathic Hospital, there have been afforded not only hospital measures for the recuperation of the mentally sick, but the indicated homeopathic remedy has been applied with conscientious fidelity in each case. 3,092 bedded, must be some OPDs there, and only indicated homeopathic remedy. No fixed remedies, no formulas, no patents, only indicated homeopathic remedy. Individualization and hospitalization and homeopathic treatment have been the method pursued in institutions under my charge during the past quarter of a century. This is what Dr. Talcott has said, that only we did individualization of patient and hospitalized the patient, and treatment was strictly homeopathic. So treatment was based on nine therapeutic principles. Now you can note it down. Number one, kindness and gentle discipline. Number two, rest as means of physical and mental recuperation. Number three, bathing and massages were used for treatment. Enforced protection, enforced feeding was done, because maniac doesn't know what is right, what is wrong. But it was not chaining. They were given protection, they were given feeding, enforced feeding and dietics. So total nine I'm telling. Exercise, amusement and occupation, moral hygiene, and treatment with homeopathic remedy. These were the nine basic principles, therapeutic principles. I'll repeat. Kindness and gentle discipline was number one. Rest as means of physical and mental recovery. And we have to see, we are overusing mobiles, we are overusing our strengths. So this might lead to dementia market. So rest is as equal as prescription of right remedy. Bathing, massage, enforced protection, enforced feeding, dietics, exercise, amusement, occupation, oral hygiene, treatment with homeopathic remedies. Now, Dr. Talcott's lecture at college covered the subjects of, these were the subjects being taught and being practiced. Number one, human brain and functions of the mind. Second was the insane diathesis on abnormal tendencies of human mind. So different diathesis. Then sleep, sleeplessness, and cure of insomnia. So now the sleep disorders are the major cause. So sleep has to be good for treatment. And history and classification of insanity, theories, definition, and requirement for the commitment. So these are the different topics. So Talcott's lecture at college covered subjects of melancholia, mania, dementia, general paresis, treatment, medical treatment and hospital construction and materia medica. These were the subjects taught. So homeopathic treatment at Middletown was based on the four cardinal principles. Number one, similia, similibus curantur means similar, cure similar. Second was the single remedy. Now, this is how shocking this is for us, because we sometimes advocate that single remedy cannot cure. So maniacs are incurable. Even till date, they are termed incurable, but they were treating it single remedy at a time, minimal dose, potentized remedy. No allopathic medicine, narcotics, or sleep-producing drugs were used at this institution. Prescriptions were based on the study of three cardinal areas: study of pathological condition, which existed in physical structure, means the pathology was treated. Mental aberrations which accompany the physical disturbances, what are the mental symptoms, and totality of symptoms as evolved by the careful study of history of each individual case. So an example of materia medica taught for treatment of insane may be found in Talcott's lecture on treatment of mania. It might be helpful because I first thought of skipping this part, but this is important, how we can proceed in maniacs. So in his address, he reviewed that the called the big four in treatment of mania. These are the big four: belladonna, hyoscyamus, stramonium of Solanaceae family, and veratrum elmum. These four, big four, were the acute survivors in that thing. He has demonstrated a case. I'll be reading that case also. Now remember this group of facts: that belladonna is fierce and brave, hyoscyamus is jolly and companionable, stramonium is wild and cowardly, and veratrum is hopeless and despairing, or wildly plaintive and beseeching for his salvation, which is apparently lost. So he thinks he has lost his salvation and he beseeches for it. On this basis, Dr. Talcott compares the symptom of this cardinal mania remedies along with other medicines. So these four big four: belladonna, stramonium, hyoscyamus, veratrum, and these remedies: aconite, bryonia, cantharis, jasinum, nuxvomica, lechasis, rostox, tarantula, veratrum brady, and sulfur. These were the other remedies used. Among his suggestions, we find hyoscyamus is a remedy that is called for when there is a lower grade of maniacal excitement than which we call for belladonna. So if it is a severe mania, hyoscyamus is not indicated. Belladonna, tear of clothing for destructiveness, while hyoscyamus, tears of clothing for the purpose of exposing the person. So if there are two patients who are tearing the clothes, belladonna would tear it in anger, while hyoscyamus will tear for exhibitionism, for the exposing the person, and for the purpose of exciting the passion of others. So to incite the sexuality in other, hyoscyamus will show off his he will be shameless. So in this lecture, Dr. Talcott mentions using belladonna in low potency in excitable patient, and 1C, 1X in other who are more dull, heavy, and stupid. So he says in maniacs, if patient is excitable, then use 3C to 30C, means higher potency, and lower potency if the patient is dull, heavy, and stupid. So belladonna can present in both the states, as we told that hypomania. So Dr. Talcott opines that stramonium case is even more fierce than belladonna. So belladonna, stramonium goes a step. So milder is hyoscyamus. If it is a severe case, belladonna and stramonium is even fierce. So he has laughing fits like hyoscyamus talking about stramonium, or rather like hyena. He waxes eloquent and pathetic in his despairing of salvation like prover of a veratrum elmum. So he says stramonium is mixture of belladonna, hyoscyamus, and veratrum. The veratrum elmum patient combines as primary effects the wildest vagaries of the religious enthusiast, the amorous frenzy of the lymphomaniac, and the excretive passions of infuriated demon, each striving for the ascendancy. So this Verrater Malbaum patient has combination of wildest vagaries of religious enthusiasm, meaning he has a religious mania also, amorous frenzy of nymphomaniac like hyoscyamus also, and excretive passion of infuriated demon means trimonium like symptoms also. Aconite is useful when there is high fever as well as mental anxiety, its restlessness and fear of death. This is Dr. Talcott's Materia Medica. So he says aconite if there is a maniac state with high fever and fear of death. Veratrum viridi, which has high fever, rapid pulse and great restlessness, often indicated the maniacal attacks to which epileptics and paralytics are subject. Nuxomica patient is obstinate, incorrigible, cross, ugly and sometimes studious. I'm a bit fast, please forgive me, because I have lot to give. Brania is also an ugly remedy, and Nuxomica patient moves about while the Brania patient keeps still, because all the symptoms are aggravated by motion. Might be you find there is nothing new, but I'm just quoting the source. I'm not adding my views to it. The Balakasis patient is very sensitive and persistently loquacious, and the prover feels as if death had overtaken. Tarantula is a remedy for crafty, cunning maniacs. Patients who are full of mischief and prone to sudden fits of destructiveness, such as knocking down pictures or sweeping bric-a-brac from a mental piece or pounding a piano or helpless child. So this is destructive. Sulfur is useful as intercurrent remedy and also for fantastic mania. When the patient decks himself in a gaudy colors, puts on old rags of future hues, bright hues, and fancies them the most elegant decorations. Then demonstration of the administration of these mania remedies is found in case of Mrs. HCE, age 27, who was treated for peripheral mania at Middletown Hospital. So see the journey of the patient. Patient was confined 6 weeks before brought to the hospital. So this patient was confined before she was suffering for more than 6 weeks. 3 days after confinement, means she delivered a baby, so it was a peripheral mania case. She was attacked with peripheral fever, which lasted about 1 week. When the fever subsided, she seemed well mentally. So initially she was all right after the confinement. 2 days afterward, then 12 days after confinement, the patient began to show signs of insanity. She was excited most of the time, obscene, religious, noisy, destructive, sleepless by spells. And for a short time, she imagined herself wealthy, but she had no fixed or continued delusion. The day following her arrival at hospital, she was very noisy and destructive. She repeatedly declared, "I'm under the flag. My ship is 45. I came here under false colors." She mistook those around her for persons she had known before. When food was taken to her, she broke the dishes. She was very violent and seemed to have hallucination of sight and hearing, which frightened her. The patient, first remedy given to patient was tremor. After several days of excitement and incoherency, she became more quiet and better natured. Then she complained of pain in the head, through the temples and over the top. Her pupils for some time were considerably dilated. Now, earlier there was no physical symptom. After stramonium, now she is feeling pain in head, through temples, pupils for some time were considerably dilated. First she called little for food. So this was, she said that after several days of stramonium, she called for food, little food, but afterwards she had excellent appetite. So her appetite improved and she started with physical symptoms. Then after some weeks of admission, she began to talk quite freely to imaginary people. Now see, earlier she was given stramonium and then no further remedy, single dose, and she was put. Then she talked quite freely to imaginary people after some weeks. So she was there for weeks. She also heard voices, but what they said did not seem to disturb her. As she was good natured and jolly, on account of her jolly delirium, her tendency to destructiveness and peculiarity for her inclination to remove all clothing, she was given hyoscyamus, and this remedy seemed to have a favorable effect for a time. At length, she began to menstruate, had a profuse flow of bright red blood, And in purpural mania, if the menses appear, this is thought to be a good sign. During her menstruation, she became more obstinate and pugilistic than usual. Her pupils were largely dilated. On account of her intense ugliness and destructiveness and dilated pupils and the flow of bright red blood from the uterus, she was given belladonna. A little later, patient was not only wild, noisy and destructive and inclined to remove all clothing, but she began to smear herself and her room with feces. She then had slight period of depression. While depressed, she inquired for her children and her husband for the first time in several weeks. Now her consciousness returned. Then she began to improve, and in about 3 months after her admission, she became quite pleasant and irrational. She continued to gain steadily, and a little less than 4 months from the date of admission, she was discharged as recovered. So 4 months of journey, only four remedies: Trimonium, Hyoscyamus, Belladonna. This is what all she was given. This case was remarkable for violence of the mental manifestation and the great physical unrest. It is considered a rather unfavorable symptom where the patient smear herself with feces, and yet in spite of that, the case recovered, though noisy and destructive and violent day and night for several weeks. She was nearly all time good-natured, as we have said before, and we have larger hope for a patient who is cheerful in spirits than for one who is depressed and crying or sullen, morose or obstinate. Now, this is what Dr. Talcott has given about one of the cases. See, reading such cases is a joy. You get such a confidence and you get so much of hints about treating your patient. So this Middletown lectures offer a glimpse of the insight of Dr. Talcott, who had observed thousands of mentally ill patients over a period embracing more than 25 years. That such humane mental institute existed in truly wonderful and would have made Samuel Hahnemann very happy. But unfortunately, we Indian has to be very cautious in this case. Unfortunately, all of the homeopathic mental hospital closed due to political repression by the AMA and the medical industrial complex, as well as withdrawal of financial support by the government. This is the irony, and we have to be very, very careful in planning our future of homeopathy in India. So now we are at the stage two of our presentation. Now I'll be coming back to one of the case. So this was a case who was brought to me in acute mental crisis. Dr. Hahnemann say this was a case of acute mania, which I'm going to show you. Some patients are prone to acute mental illness, including mania or nervous breakdown. This is accompanied by intellectual confusion, sensorial distortion, and emotional mood swings. Strong emotional stress, trauma, shock, fright, vexation, grief, loss, drinking, and drugs often trigger this type of crisis. These sudden mental disorders are often based on internal sora that flares up like flames and burns the patient's mind. So I'm presenting a case of 12 years old boy. Some of those who attend my Wednesday morning classes, they have been shown this case. So this was a boy who was brought to me. See, the mother is closing that because he sometimes runs away. I'm lowering the voice because there are not much dialogues. So you see this this is a bit long interview, but you will see that she is making the faces. You can appreciate that. So he is just behaving, he is making the faces without any reason, right? Then if he was given something to eat, so he was hungry for eating. Whatever he gets, this is a peanuts, so he'll just snatch away anything edible around, even rather go to the garbage dump and would eat any rotten apple or anything from that dump. Otherwise, so then you see he is eating these peanuts, and later on in the later part, he is trying to run away. So the mother is again holding him. So he was, this time patient is under sedation, right? Then you see this, he will then start eating those from ground. He will start singing sometime. Then he is picking up that garbage, the peanut shells outside, which he has thrown down. He will again start picking and eating. So he had violent faces also. So this is a long video. So in every posture, he is a different. And right now, before bringing to us, he was in hospitalization and he was given shocks, and doctor said that you have to send him asylum, forget about his studies. Right now he is under heavy dose of sedation. He has been given a lot of, and he's talking, I went to school, whether he is not going to school. He's talking all relevant. There is no relevance in his talking. So you observe this, and when you later observe, you will see the changes in him within 2 weeks of giving. See, now he's picking those shells again and eating them. So this was a case. This is how the case goes. So boy of 12 years was brought in condition of mania. He was having some abnormal energy levels and mother need to restrict him from going out. He was having no discrimination of what to eat, what not to eat. Mother said he was picking from the garbage and whatever is edible, non-edible. So there were cow was eating something. He just snatched it from cow and the cow was behind him. So he is snatching the food from the dogs and cows, and he has no discrimination in what to eat, what not to eat. He was not having good eye contact and was not very considerate about what is told to him. Occasionally following commands without any involvement or understanding. So mother said he was never like this. All this started few days back when the child went to the countryside and missed the bus going to the grandparents, and mother and son had to walk few kilometers in the burning sun. It was the only bus which goes, one in the morning and one in the evening. They reached by 11:30 and the bus left just few minutes back. So they were to walk around 6-7 kilometers in the burning sun. He suffered sunstroke with high fever, for which he was carried to a local quack who first prescribed antipyretic, but fever didn't come down. So the child was put on strong antibiotics, analgesics for getting his fever down. Fever got down, but during that period, child started behaving abnormally. They waited for night, but when it didn't recover, then they carried the child to Ludhiana Abhikar Institution. He was admitted and started with psychiatric treatment. Strong psychotic drugs were given to the child without any relief. After keeping him for a few days in hospital, doctor started counseling the parents for shock treatment, to which parents got frightened and got patient discharged. So in this video, you can see condition of child when he was brought to us. Next, you can see in the video, child not looking like normal child, still under sedation. So his energy level is not that hyper now, but still we can feel that there is something which need to be treated. So as a homeopath, we need to understand his concept now. And what is to be treated in patient has to be clearly demarcated. This is what Dr. Hahnemann said, that in a given case, you have to first recognize what is to be treated. So some symptom which mother told was, mother noticed that child is more anxious and restless before passing school. Now you have to, out of so many symptoms, you have to take out some symptoms, the change in his routine. So mother said that his activity levels change before passing the school, always needed to be restricted from escaping out. In general, patient is cheerful, not very irritable. In organ of medicine, in one-sided disease, as we have already studied in theory part, that in such an acute case, we need to prescribe certain remedy on basis of current status. So how to proceed? Now, if you go to the literature, during the psoriatic crisis, it is necessary to administer a psoriatic acute intercurrent rather than chronic medicine. So acute intercurrent, you must know the concept of acute intercurrent, chronic intercurrent, miasmatic intercurrent, then the constitutional drug and acute prescription. So you have to understand all these concepts. Dr. Hahnemann has given 5 to 6 different strategies of intercurrents. So such a case cannot be treated straight away in its acute onset with anti-psoriatic medicine. So we are not at all thinking of prescribing any constitutional drug to such a patient. So what is Master's strategy, Dr. Hanneman's strategy? So he said that it must be treated with the medicine such as it is written in Organon of Medicine Art, Dr. Hanneman's O'Reilly 6th edition, Aphorism 221, that it has first to be treated with medicine such as aconite, belladonna, stramonium, hyoscyamus, and mercury. So I thought of these remedies, out of these remedies, selected from other class of proven remedies, that is the psoriasis. So acute remedy is only capable of removing the acute-like symptoms. The most emphasis is placed on those symptoms that are marked, peculiar, and rare to the patient, not those common to all diseases. So now we have to filter the mania symptoms. So this indiscrimination, hyperactivity, destructiveness, eating soil, all these things, indigestible things, we cannot consider that. These are the common symptoms. So I have, as I've told you, that given information given by mother that he becomes restless before going to school was the gem of the symptoms I got, because this is not a mania symptom. Then that symptom of being trying to escape, but not very, but so escape desire to was another symptom which I took. So these were the symptoms I took, and considering the acute remedy suggested by Dr. Hanneman. So anxiety before school, he is foolish and cheerful. He is not weeping and not very irritable. And Dr. Hanneman, Dr. Talcott has told that those cases who are cheerful are easier to treat than those who are sad and who are depressed. Gluttony, he is eating anything. Escape attempts to restless drive from one place to other. So this was the Merxol was given. And you see the result. See this man who forgot, this boy who forgot all the studies, and he was not at all stable. Now see how diligent he is. And he said that everything he read was forgot, and now he remembered everything. He was not going to school. Now mother is saying that his life has been changed. मदर सेज हमें तो लगता ही नहीं है कि इसको कुछ था अभी. सी द रिकवरी. सेज इज नॉट ईटिंग एनीथिंग नाउ. ही इज टोटली अ नॉर्मल बॉय ही वाज बिफोर गेटिंग सिक. It took almost 3 weeks for me to get this result. See the difference. I'll show you the earlier video again. Once again, see the difference. See, this is the one of the earlier state where he was totally senseless, and see now this state where he is so senseless. So no account should be patient be considered cured after they recover from acute mania. Now here what Dr. Hanneman says, that they are not cured. Acute melancholy or primary delusion sanity, then you have to choose for this reason. should be retaken. Case should be retaken with the aim of finding the most complementary chronic remedy. A study of miasmatic relationship of symptom group. Frequently, the patient is still in my touch. I later on. So here it is written in Bonninghausen Concordance and relationship of remedies found in Materia Medica are very helpful in finding the second prescription. Now, Bonninghausen Concordance, I am sorry to say, but many of our students, they are not aware of this chapter of Bonninghausen. And it says that after mental illness in follow-up, if the complaints come to the liver, comes to the digestive system, if they come to the skin, what remedies you have to follow? If such a patient is not given anti-miasmatic treatment, the latent miasm will flare up again in a more protected attack for less apparent reason. Such attack may take on periodic character until they become chronic state and are more difficult to cure. So I still am in touch with this patient and he was given. So it is a long case. I'll show it somewhere else in a special workshop because I'm rushing through many, leaving many points aside. So on rare occasion, somewhat protected mental disorder will appear if we don't give the constitutional remedy after the patient is out of this acute state. Then they said that it may reoccur and lead to some chronic state. So protected mental disorder will appear to subside by itself. In these cases, the psychic element will ameliorate while the physical symptom become worse. So there are so many symptoms, so many other vectors in this. And this is sign that the chronic miasm still lurks within and has potential to be transferred to the intellect and emotional disturbance. When mental and emotional diseases are truly cured, the physical organism will prosper and become healthy. After many years of observation, Hahnemann developed a differential diagnosis to distinguish those cases based on poor upbringing, unethical activities, bad habits, neglect of the spirit, superstition or ignorance from those cases based upon somatic disease and chronic miasm. So if the mental disease, fully developed, the following modality provide insight into the cause. Okay? If it stems from the latter, right? Faculty upbringing bad habits, then the mental disease will subside and improve with understanding, well-intentional exaltation, consolation or with earnest and rational exploration. What Dr. Hahnemann says in this slide is that if it is coming from some physical sickness or they are due to bad habits or bad parenting, if mental disease will subside and improve with understanding. So counseling and a change of environment will help in that cases. A consolation will help. Understanding the patient and talking to the patient will help. But if it is a mental or emotional disease that is really based upon a somatic disease, it will rapidly worse with such treatment. So you see in OCD patients, in the patients with this severe psychic disorder, even hypochondria patient, if you still keep on giving counseling and trying to make understand, this makes the patient further worse. Counseling has no role in such cases. So melancholic patient will become still more downcast, plaintive, disconsolate and withdrawn. Someone who is maliciously insane will become still more embittered and senseless talk will become obviously more nonsensical. So you have to differentiate between the cases where you need change of environment, where you need counseling, where you need what medicine. This is what in O'Reilly's sixth edition has written. So what is role of counseling in psychiatric cases? Hahnemann's differential is that psychosomatic diseases are better by psychological support, but while disease based on organic pathology are worse by psychological support. So all cases don't need the psychological psychotherapy, what cognitive behavior therapy and all that. Even allopathy is still doing that. He says that certain cases, you have to understand the cases which need a psychotherapy and which doesn't need a psychotherapy. As in previous slide, it is said that if you are giving psychotherapy to the patient who are not needing that, now that diagnosis is must. It will further worsen the case. This is why those with chronic miasm become worse under therapy. It is as if soul of the patient wishes to respond positively and act directly on the body. But the deranged physical organ is moreover react against the psychosis are using the mental and emotional organ even greater suffering. So I saw one of the video on I'm taking just one example on this TED Talks. He said that many a people they receive the injury to the head and that lead to the psychiatric illnesses. Till that injury to the head is addressed, so we have hypericum, arnica, and natrum, so many injury remedies. Until unless we consider that for into, and we cannot help such patients. So this is one example. So there, such patient need to undergo homeopathic treatment in conjunction with psychological counseling. Once the remedies begin to act, therapies that were not effective begin to produce fruits. So before that, you have to give that one of the acute remedy, understand the patient, pacify the patient with homeopathy, then all that things will work. So disease spun and maintained by the soul. He has named this disease spun and maintained by the soul. There are mental and emotional diseases that develop in psyche and progress to the somatic spheres. Such patient show few physical symptoms because their disorder develops from shock, worry, mortification, vexation, abuse, or repeated exposure to great fear or fright. Initially, there will be little physical infirmity, but in time, somatic complaint of serious nature will develop. It is only these emotions. Because I'm giving you example, most of the OCD patient are they become OCD patient due to, I have seen many of the patient, those who have been sexually assaulted in early childhood. So that fear, that danger, and that disturbance, that continued fear, and that has got, or a sudden fear. So most of the cases, when there is something severely against their wish has happened, that leads to OCD patient. This is giving what example. So I know many a time student asks, sir, I need your help in one of the case. So these are not the cases which can be helped on WhatsApp or. You have to have the observation. You have to have the depth knowledge. Only then you can discuss these cases. By just helping on WhatsApp doesn't help. So it is only these emotional diseases which were first spun and maintained by the soul that allow themselves to be rapidly transformed into well-being of the soul by psychotherapeutic means, displays of trust, friendly exhortation, reasoning with the patient, and even well-camouflaged deception. So this helps. So this is very important. With appropriate living habits, these diseases apparently also allow themselves to be transformed into well-being of the body. However, such approaches will be effective only if the emotional disease is new and has not yet deranged the somatic state too much. When a disease is originally spun by the soul, the patient respond well to psychological therapy and proper lifestyle. These psychotherapeutic method will only cure if the emotional disturbance is superficial and has not yet deranged the somatic state too deeply. See, this is what I'm repeating and again. All cases will not respond to the psychological therapy. A long-term psychosomatic disease will progress to the stage where it produces organic pathology. So this can be shown in MRI or any, because these are many mental state with appear from nephrotic shock, from hepatic shock, from encephalitic shock. So this state require counseling and treatment with chronic remedies. These predispose to such somatic state well, often suffer from inherited and acquired miasm. To ensure against a relapse into a similar mental state, the convalescent period should be given a thorough anti-psoriatic and probably anti-syphilitic treatment. Now, all these things need a lot of expansion and details. So there are many, many slides. I have around 50, 60 slides left, but time has flown away. So I'll be taking it somewhere else because I cannot justify. So Hahnemann called psychology a diet for the soul, but not effective for all. So Hahnemann strategy, it's a long, long presentation. I have many cases. So I promised you that I will conclude at 6:15. Now I hope so. There is a lot of special materia medica given by Hahnemann, which is effective in psychiatric illnesses. So all remedies they have there, Hahnemann has suggested particular indication of the remedies. So conclusion is, Hahnemann was the opinion that no one in mental institution is ever really and permanently cured by old school. Homeopathic treatment, however, has potential to produce rapid cures of old mental disorder that arise from psychic or somatic cause or both simultaneously. So with that, I take your leave. Thank you. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity to present. I thank IAHP and all the office bearer who have trust in me, and thank you all once again. Thank you.
Hello,
Dr. Dahad.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. Muktinder Singh. Yeah, I'm able to hear. Thank you very much, Dr. Muktinder Singh. Actually, he appropriately has explained the things, very marathon presentation, and very lot of information he has provided us. Now I'm requesting to Dr. A.D. Mahajan, sir, please give your opinion about his presentation. Dr. Mahajan, sir.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
You are audible, sir. Please.
Yes, sir. Good evening, all the viewers and the lovers of IHP and homeopathy.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. See, all the lovers and viewers of the IHP and homeopathy, distinguished giant personalities of the IHP, distinguished dynamic president Dr. Amy Rao sir, daring, dashing, vital force of IHP, my proud colleague, today's speaker, Dr. Muktinder Singh ji, young scientists, researchers, PG scholars, interns, and all the viewers, ladies and gentlemen. If homeopathy has to survive in the future, Hahnemannian homeopathy needs to be reinvented, rediscovered in the parameters of a modern medical science. At the outset, I must express my heartfelt gratitude to all of you to allow me to participate and witness in a such a noble webinar. My friends, we appreciate and applaud all the work done by the organizing committee of the webinar. There are many different ways of thinking about human behavior. Scientists and researchers utilize a variety of perspectives when studying how people think, how people feel, and how they behave. Some researchers focus on a special school of thought, such as biological perspectives, while others take more an eclectic approach that incorporates multiple points of view. Homeopathy always considers all aspects of a life of a person or a patient and treats accordingly on the principle of individualization. So my friends, theory and practice must always go hand in hand. We must practice homeopathy, what we study in a theory. The theoretical part is a very nicely summarized by the speaker. That means we are just revising all the class studies. It must be now need of the hour is patient oriented all the time. Thanks to Dr. Ajay Dhat for kind and sweet words. IHP, as we all know, is always striving hard for the excellence in homeopathy. With respect to our motto, Dr. Muktinder Singh ji, as like the father of repertory, Dr. Boni Hossain, is a 2-9 type personality, a very fastidious, meticulous man, and we have just experienced the last 1 hour. He has explained how homeopathy is effective in a mental disorders from almost all angles. Now, as far as we know, here, coming to the topics, he has covered everything, nothing left. But I wish that the dream should be reality. Our interns and residents in almost all recognized homeopathic medical colleges, homeopathic institutions, should get a chance as like MBBS medicos to expose with the number of patients every day, so that the superiority of homeopathy, which as Hahnemann has claimed in Apagon 230 with respect to mental and emotional disease, should be practiced, and the students, interns, all the homeopathic fraternity should really get that experience. So really, this today, now what to speak about mental disease? Everything has been covered. Credit goes to Muktinder Singhji for revising everything. Now, in short, just to brief you, everyone is a mental. Every patient that consults the doctor is a mental when he speaks to you. As we know, speech is the index of mind. Mind is a key to the man. But my friends, M-I-N-D, mind is a never defined. Mind has no boundaries of national or international parameters or the measurements. Homeopathy is ultimately your own state of mind applied to the mind of the patient. So how to apply this has been very nicely and very lucidly explained by Dr. Muktinder Singhji. We all know Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, who is a guru of medicine, who revolutionized the field of medicine into homeopathy. He is a one five type of personality, like Kent's famous constitutional cycle, sulfur, calcarea, lycopodium. He is the most industrious leader, guru in a medicine, who revolutionized the field of medicine into homeopathy. Now, last two centuries, what has happened is a very nicely presented by our speaker in a just a 1 hour, relevant to the topic in a systematic and analytical manner. Now, what we learn, my friends, homeopathy, as compared to contemporary world of medicine, has a very distinct approach towards life itself, health of a person, disease itself, symptoms of the general disease, as well as the person or patient, the medicine that what we prescribe, the cure, as well as the most important part is management, earning our bread and butter. So with reference to that, managing the cases of a mental disorder depends on the skill and the clinical acumen of an attending physician. And this has been shortly or briefly, because of short of time, has explained by Dr. Muktinder Singhji. Now, patients that are attending in our clinic are of generally, just to cover upon 210 to 230 from Organon, in a today's world, are simply five types. Number one, is a psychogenic. That is what we say, emotional disorders, or generally mania. That is what very nicely presented by Muktinder Singhji. So psychogenic, which has been stressed by Muktinder Singhji. Number two are psychosomatic. Now we know how the constitutional prescribing has been done on a psychosomatic basis. Third is a very, very important, somatopsychic. Somatopsychic, that means generally what we read in the books of the clinical medicine, surgery, gynec. So these diseases, when they enter into CNS complications. So the CNS complications of in general disease can be considered as a somatopsychic. The more fourth and most important is where we have restricted but definitely very good medicines, that is a psychiatric. And the fifth one, which Hahnemann has introduced, doubtful in origin, may or may not belong to this 1, 2, 3, 4. So doubtful in origin. So these five types of the disease, which Hahnemann has very nicely elaborated in upon 210 to 230 and has been summarized just now by Dr. Muktinder Singhji. So we all know this in daily practice, we all differ from that maybe a simple delirium, simple phobia or fear or anxiety, to the most complex phenomena like schizophrenia, OCDs, perception disorders, from childhood, that is a pediatric field, to the geriatric age field. So we all will find they may come with the simple symptoms, simple symptoms, to the much multiple organ involvement. So likewise, there are many patients that come in a mild, moderate and severe sufferings. So all types have been explained by Dr. Muktindin Singh ji in a very brief time. Now, it's a really great challenge, and that we have to accept the challenge. Coming back to the most important thing, now how he has summarized, just to briefly in a few minutes, I'll just summarize. So he started with the three parts of his presentations, with the effectiveness of homeopathy, glorious journey of past, present, future, and then Anemonian perspective. So he started with that mania. Simply mania means what? Nothing but simple words in literal meaning, or for day-to-day common, madness. Pagale, mental. So mental itself is a mania, and that is why mind is a mirror. Likewise, he presented how mania is a mirror of that patient. So he explained with this bipolar mood disorders. So then he entered into that, we know, three idiots, how their three idiots are, Barata Cobb, Elaborus, and Meridorinum. Likewise, mental retardedness. He explained with the epilepsy, mental retardedness. The most important part is, we'll find that because of the ADR, adverse drug effects, because of the adverse drug reactions, the many patients come with so many different types of mental symptoms in a daily life. It may be depression, it may be melancholia, it may be sleepiness, it may be sleeplessness, insomnia. So which then coming to most important is the dementia. So these four types of the dementia has been very nicely presented by Muktinder Singh ji. Now likewise, he gave very nice explanation with a veratrum album, and we know all the type of liars in the world of homeopathy. Veratrum album is the leading liar, opium is another liar, and likewise we have so many other drugs. But with reference to that, whatever he presented about the past, and so glorious examples and figures and pictures that he showed, what we should, that dream should be reality. What is the need of the world is, history should repeat prophecy. So all that Hahnemann's legacy of the patients, homeopathic OPDs, homeopathic hospitals should be posterity in homeopathic fraternity. Interns and residents are in need of such facilities. I really earnestly appeal to all the CEC members of IISP to offer such services under government patronage, so that the future of IISP will be very bright, future of homeopathy will be very bright. What we study in theory should be really in action for the students. It is not only, putting in the lecture, class, or generally in the seminar or in a webinar. It must be a reality, and I request IISP CC members to look into this matter. So then Muktinder Singh suggested very nice 9 therapeutic principles to treat the mentals. Very good one. With along with what is known as the auxiliary methods. He presented Belladonna, Iosimus, Timonium, Veratrum, very true. But I request all the, generally, the especially the beginners. So in brief, you want to be confident, please go through ML Tyler's pointers to the common remedies with reference to the mental affections. Very, very good drugs. The command on that book itself will help you in a daily general practice. So excellent cases have been demonstrated by Muktinder Singh ji. Now he presented one acute mania case. Likewise, I have also seen one female patient, 20 years, from a rural area. She was brought with the 7 persons along with her in my clinic, where she was suffering from only mania because of the illiterate people were torturing the parents, the neighbors, the society members, and because she had amenorrhea, and everybody suspected because in the rural area something else, which was a single case. I took in privacy, and I found that when lacacistanium with a single dose relieved all her complaints. So likewise, now in brief, for the beginners, there should be, as far as prescriptions are concerned, for every case you think simply 3 types of prescription. To begin with, follow with acute totality, acute prescribing, acute generally methods, and instructions given by Hahnemann for acute. Starting from aposome 88 to 73-74, then introduced by just now aposome 221, aposome 82, second half. So you consider and you prescribe it with benefits. Likewise, then coming to the chronic and constitutional, this is a very common everywhere, it is known. And most important now, because of the so many obstacles in the present day era, nothing is pure. So I request my friends, as Hanuman said in Apagram 3 itself, we must learn obstacles in the way of recovery and how to remove those obstacles. For that, intercurrents are the best. That is a speciality of homeopathy where we do not find any other systems of medicine. Management also followed trio, prescription, as well as diet and regimen, which is a three-dimensional, and as well as auxiliary measures, including psychotherapy. One of the important points which I would like to mention from Organon itself, the concept of lucid interval introduced by Hahnemann is a very, very significant. Prescribing during that lucid interval is a different, and this prescribing during acute attack of the suffering of that mental disorder is a different. So you please follow lucid interval. It's a very significant. Likewise, psychotherapy. Hahnemann has added in a sixth edition of Organon about psychotherapy. So please use that psychotherapy, counseling, etc., etc. Now, most important point which I like most, that introduced by Dr. Muktinder Singh, like Boninghausen, as I told you, he is a Boninghausen, living Boninghausen. Most important, doctrine of concordance. So relations really matter in the life of a human beings. So likewise, the relationships for the drugs given in especially Allen's keynotes are very significant. The more you concentrate that, better for your own success in your own practice. Now, if you permit me, few minutes with reference to RISP and our first, because 25th September is the birthday of our founder, Dr. K.G. Saxena of RISP. He's a man of struggle for homeopathy. And his mission, as you know, his mission, last that 91 years what he served, he was, the total mission was a government patronage to homeopathy, you know, homeopathic education, homeopathic practice, homeopathic pharmacies, homeopathic research, and homeopathic jobs. I request the obvious bearers of the IHP to follow his mission in action. Now, as far as our own present president, Dr. Amir Rao, sir, he is a man who is born on 2nd February 1950 to one type of personality, as we have Kent's famous cycle, Pulsatilla, Cilicia, and Lycopodium. So that Lycopodium, he is a Lycopodium personality, a man of principles and organization, a dedicated, disciplined devotee of homeopathy, a determined doctor of practice in homeopathy. So he is, now I appeal to all of you that please, interns and residents in a recognized homeopathic medical college in India are a needy, dynamic, young scholars who will join IISP if they get practical and clinical patient-oriented training in homeopathic hospitals run by IISP under government patronage, which I request present CC to note down. Next, coming to that latest one. Latest, my friends, in the last week, National Commission for Homeopathy Bill recently has been passed in the Lok Sabha, which defines homeopathy in a new way. It defines as homeopathy means the homeopathic system of medicine and includes use of biochemical remedies, and whether supplemented or not, by such a modern medicine and modern advances as the commission may, in consultation with the central government, declare by notification from time to time. Now, what it means is, what has happened in the last 230 is not important. What is going to happen in future is more important. Homeopathy is a public, homeopathy is a public health sector, that is, now, need of the world is to enter into the mass basis. From the class people, we have to go to the mass people. So now, henceforth, it should be more to the grassroots level homeopathic practitioners. So our motto should be, yes, few minutes. Our motto should be to integrate homeopathy in a national health policy. Here, my request, Kent's concept of constitutional cycles and their related remedies, on the basis of the state of disposition and mind, which will be easily perceived by the numerological numbers, that is by the date of birth, that means the day the person is born, birth number and life number, which will simplify homeopathic prescribing in masses, that is a public health sector. So homeopathic prescribing on a numerological basis, which I am practicing for last 30 years. So in almost all cases may help us in a maybe curative line of treatment, preventive line of treatment, preservative line of treatment as per apostle number 4, a prophylactic treatment, and the most important is a palliative line of treatment as well as in a daily clinical practice. This will help us to promote and popularize homeopathy not only at the national level but global level as well. So now ultimately, just last 1 minute, so I must express my heartfelt gratitude for giving me this opportunity to our president of honor, Dr. V.K. Gupta sir, present president Dr. M.A. Rao sir, the present speaker Dr. Muktinder Singh ji, Dr. Ravindra Kochar, Dr. Tanveen Hussain doing very good job, Dr. G. Srivanshalu, and today agenda started Dr. Ajay Dahar. The inn, my friends, the inn that shelters for the night is not the journey's end. We have to march on. Everything that begins has to end. So I am grateful to all of you, all the viewers, listeners, participants, life members, and office bearers of the ISP for giving me this opportunity to chair the webinar and address the gathering. Thanks all of you for the silent listening and sharing the webinar. Let me end with just a few words. Sujano na yati vairam parahitakare vinashakarepi. Chedepi Chandanataru Surabhayati Mukham Kutarasya. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Mahajan sir. Before going ahead, I want to add one thing what I have been noted. Very saliently, Dr. Muktinder Singh has presented, reorganized, relinked the past, present, and future. Many of the times that question come in our mind, why we are studying the past, but actually past, that means history gives clue for the present as well as future. We can learn and we can rectify the mistakes what has been happened knowingly, unknowingly in the past. So he has very appropriately relinked and reorganized. And thank you very much for that. One more point, as he has been added, in general, in the treatment and management of mental diseases, we are mistaken, that is the counseling for all the cases. But he has differentiated, especially the cases from the origin of organic changes or somatopsychic cases. Thank you very much, Muktinder Singh ji, as well as thank you very much to Dr. Mahajan sir. Now I am requesting to Dr. Tanveer Hussain, a very glorious person of IIHP. Please, Dr. Tanveer. Dr. Tanveer, please unmute yourself. Dr. Tanveer, please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now? Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yeah. Now audible.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Ajay Dahar sir, for this nice introduction. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Muktinder Singh for his nice presentation. He has really taken real pains to go into the past of this all the regarding the history of Dr. Honeyman's own way of treatment in mental cases. Dr. Honeyman is very rightly said in his after the treatment of this case that all the mental or insane patients are not suitable to treat at their homes. So it is the need of the time that if we are having 5 days a very good number of mental patients or insane kind of patients, that it would be very nice if we can have some kind of homeopathic mental asylum as it was there in the past, so we can come up with more good results. We can show the potentiality of homeopathic medicines where we can all work together in that way. So Dr. Muktinder has very nicely taken up this history of all that from Dr. Honeyman, especially because we are all reading the literature from the past only, where from we can, the person who can see the longer in the past, he can see further in the future, as very rightly said by Dr. Ajay Dahar also said. So he has shown very nice case of acute crisis of mental illness. It was very interesting case. The time was little short, so that we could try much more cases also of similar kind from the mania or from other mental disorders. Dr. Honeyman says in after the treatment of these mental illnesses that from the part of the physician, there are three things which are very important to be there. Three qualities in physician. Number one is friendliness with the patient. Number two, humanity with the patient, plus the firmness from the part of the physician. If these three things are there in the physician, then we can treat these types of cases very successfully. So I congratulate Dr. Kinder for this presentation, and the Dr. Mahajan sir, who has very nicely complimented his lecture. He has given some new ideas also regarding introduction of the administration of the medicines, regarding the concept of glycerin turmeric. He has given this importance also. It is very important to note. And the special emphasis which was given by Dr. Mukinder regarding the use of concordance chapter, it is very, very useful, especially when we are going to search for the second prescription. Remedy relationship is very, very important, and unfortunately, many of our people, they are not using this part of Dr. Boni's repository. So I thank Dr. Mukinder Singh for today's session. I thank Dr. Arvind Mahajanji for giving us very nice talk, the complimentary talk for Dr. Mukinder Singh's lecture, and he has given special time for us today. Dr. Ajay Dhar sir has very nicely played his role as a moderator. I love to listen to him, because one day I would like to listen to his own lecture. He is very good in organon. He is having very thorough knowledge of it. Sir, we would love to enjoy your lecture also in this platform. So yes, please, sir. Please give some time to us, please. So I thank whole IIHP team, especially our President of Honor, respected Dr. V.K. Gupta sir, National President Dr. M.A. Rao sir, all CEC members of IIHP, all state presidents, all state secretaries, and members of IHP, whole life members of IHP, all the audiences who are there still with us, and they have given us very qualitative time. We have really enjoyed it. Dr. Mukinder, we would love to listen in the future if we can come up with more cases so that everybody can learn more practical aspect of this. So with these words, I thank one and all once again. Thank you very much, Dr. Ajay Dharji, Dr. everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Mukinder Singh, should we conclude now?
Yes, as the chair says, I'm just a participant now. Is there any, we can take one, two questions, because questions? There are time limits.
Any questions from the audience?
Yes, there
is no question so far I have been found. Only one request is there. In future, more time has been given to Dr. Mukinder Singh and more opportunity to explore on the mental disorders. So he has, on behalf of him, I am telling to them, I assure definitely he will present in future also. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Really, okay, bye. Thank you.
Really, psychiatric illness are very challenging nowadays. There is no future in this form.
Yeah, sure.